Welcome to Bible Believers Fellowship and the ministry of BBFOhio.com and this special study taught on Christmas Day 2016 titled Christmas and the Gospel. We took a break from our regular expository Bible studies, having canceled the previous Sunday due to icy road conditions, and decided we'd talk about some issues being created by folks that we call holiday hunters. For 3 decades as a Christian, I have led local churches in using this time of year to proclaim the incarnation to the world and to explain why the coming of Jesus Christ as a babe in Bethlehem was so important. And of course, that is so that he could die for our sins and be raised from the dead in victory over sin, death, and hell. Christmas is about the incarnation, and the incarnation of Jesus Christ is about the gospel. However, in recent years, a growing number of novices and infantile believers have joined ranks with the Puritan legalists, Jehovah's Witnesses, Oneness Pentecostals, and other cults in turning this time of year into a time of denouncing other believers. They ignore Romans 14 and Colossians 2, and they create their own version of the law, sowing discord among brethren, and sadly, basing much of what they claim on lies, cult propaganda, and not on the facts. So in this study, we discuss some of the lies and misinformation spread by holiday hunters in their verbal assaults against Bible believers at Christmas time. And we end by reminding everyone that the reason for the season is the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ, no matter what season. If you have any questions, comments, or prayer requests after hearing this study, you can send those by email to bbbfohio@yahoo.com, or you can send your letter to P.O. Box 662, Worthington, Ohio, 43085. And now our study titled Christmas and the Gospel. This is part 1 of 2.
Amen. That's a little nativity that is at my grandmother, Doris's. My grandma, Mariah's great-grandma, Gloria's great-great-grandma, Doris. And that's in her little bay window. And I just love that little, I love those little nativities in the house. But by the way, I just wanted to let you know officially, Ohio does have a white Christmas. If you look real close, you'll see right there, there's the snow in the Miller. See? It's a Christmas miracle. Yeah, the Browns won yesterday. Something's wrong in the universe. These are the last days. Yes. All right, so if you would, I just want to read one verse to start with. This is going to be one of those independent fundamental Baptist sermons where I read a verse and then say nothing that has anything to do with it.
Okay.
Just kidding, just kidding. 1 Timothy 1:15. Wonderful passage we're going to read. I'm going to give you a second to get there. It's one that I encourage you to underline or highlight or whatever you do with your important verses of the Bible. We talk about Christmas and the gospel. This is really what it's all about, 1 Timothy 1:15. You would read that with me. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. That's Paul who wrote that, the apostle. And he's not bragging. What he's trying to do is tell you that Jesus came to save sinners without exception.
Amen. Amen.
That there's no such thing as a chosen few that God has died to save, and that he only died to save the elect. That's nonsense.
Amen.
Christ Jesus came to save sinners. He died for the sins of the whole world, the Bible says.
Amen.
He's not willing that any should perish.
Amen.
And you know, I could be a Calvinist if no one ever went to hell. Because Calvinism teaches that God chose to save those who according to his good pleasure, he wanted to save. Well, then the Bible tells us he's not willing that any should perish.
Right.
Therefore, if God saved everybody and forced everybody into heaven, I could be a Calvinist. But he didn't, so I'm not. Christ Jesus came into the world. That's what we're supposed to be focused on during this time of year.
Amen.
Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners.
Amen.
Now, before we move on, I'm just going to say this. If you get off onto anything else at this time of the year that makes you lose focus of that, you lose.
Amen.
Satan defeated you. He's not going to win the war. You're still saved, but you lost that battle.
Amen.
If you're a Christian today and you have been focused on things other than the fact that Jesus came to die for your sins, was buried, and rose again, that's what every morning should be your focus.
Amen.
Not just Christmas. Not just Sunday. How many of you know Sunday Christians? 6 days of the week, it's me, 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 me is their praise song. They worship that idol they look at in the mirror every morning. But then Sunday, they give God an hour. And some people don't want to give God more than 45 minutes. That's why they won't come here, because we take almost 2 hours. And if you stick around for fellowship, we're here 3 hours. Or four, according to who you are. And if your idol isn't you, and you wake up every morning saying, this is God's day. I'm going to serve God. I'm going to flip the burgers. I said burgers too, by the way. I'm going to take care of that window and the orders. I'm going to deliver that milk. I'm going to make sure people in IT do their job. I'm going to, going through the, I know what most of you do during the day. It's to the glory of God. And you dedicate your day to serving Him and working as unto the Lord.
Amen.
And then along the way, you might get a chance to talk to somebody about Jesus.
Amen.
But even if you don't get to talk about Him, you get to show people that you're different. There's something different about you.
Amen.
And it might be... See, I get a bad rap because I try to tell people this lifestyle evangelism is really a false teaching. Because lifestyle is just part of it, and if all you do is live the life and say, I just want to live the life, and then they'll just want to be saved. Nonsense. Ain't going to happen.
Amen.
But you can live a lifestyle of which, when you have the opportunity to talk to them about Jesus, they'll listen.
Amen.
You see, what a lot of Christians do is they live the kind of lifestyle that makes you think Christianity is a disease. I don't want it.
Yeah.
Keep your distance. But if you live the lifestyle that you should live as a Christian, then when you have the opportunity to talk to them about Jesus, they'll listen. And if you wake up every day with the... I just wake up and just sit and think about how in awe of the fact that Jesus is God manifest in the flesh who came into the world to save sinners. We choose to major on major points of Christmas. At this time of the year. There are all kinds of things about Christmas that need to be changed.
Amen.
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 There are all kinds of things about Christmas that are wrong or misguided. I still think, Charlie, you shouldn't change that shirt. I really think you should keep the shirt. But some people do make Santa Claus the reason for the season. And, I don't condemn people who have fun with the Santa Claus thing with their kids, but we just never... Santa would have been out of work if it was up to the Millers, because we just, my kids knew I was Santa if there was one. If there was a Santa Claus, it's me. Yeah, I want credit where it's due. Amen?
Amen.
But, I know some people think it's just like, Batman or playing Toy Soldier or whatever, and they play the game. But there is something wrong when you let anything, including Santa or whatever, block your view. That's the problem. But if you will major on major points that Christ Jesus came into the world. See, there is a need, I believe, for Christians to kind of get into it. But not into the world's idea of it, but get into the incarnation. Get into it. How do you say
it? Oh, I find your lack of Christmas spirit disturbing.
How was that?
Okay.
I'm not even a Star Wars fan. I can do that one. There are way too many distractions that Satan uses at this time of year to bury this message from our heart and from public view. Yeah. One of them is not having a sense of humor, by the way. But, people will joke. I'll see on Facebook or social media, and they'll post something that's funny. And then one of the first people jump on there, they give a discourse or something on how wrong that is. Jesus wasn't born on December 25th, which no one knows for sure. And there weren't three wise men. Well, we don't know that for sure either. It doesn't say three, but it doesn't say there weren't three.
Right.
See what I'm saying? Some of these know-it-alls don't really know as much as they know, or they think they know. And some of the stuff they know is just wrong. Why major on that? Why be distracted with all that stuff? I love this. What's wrong with this nativity scene? Mariah posted this. And of course, most of us would notice the T-Rex. But there are certain people would notice there's something wrong with this. The wise men didn't come till years later. You see the difference in attitude?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I didn't even notice that.
I don't even know what they're called.
So the question is, this time of the year, are you majoring on the majors or are you being a pain? Not just to yourself, I mean to those around you. You could use these things to really talk about Jesus, to lift up Jesus. It's distractions that Satan, this time of year, you could really be all about Jesus and everything. And Satan has so many weapons that he uses as distractions. One of them is the world's materialistic perversion of this time of year. Instead of thinking about how wonderful it is that God came as a baby to die for sins, and as a result, look at all the blessings you have. There's nothing wrong with getting together with family. There's nothing wrong with decorating your house and putting on pretty music and all that. But you should understand that all these things are blessings that would mean nothing without Jesus Christ. But you get into, I know so many people this time of year is horrible for them. And they have to budget thousands of dollars to spend or charge up their credit cards, and they're worried they're going to get the wrong thing and the kid's going to throw a fit, or mom, is going to throw a fit, or grandma or grandpa is going to throw a fit. I know people who their grandparents would throw gifts across the room because they didn't like what they got.
Wow.
Yeah, I've seen it. I mean, I've seen this with my own eyes. I know it happens. That's just a shame. And then the poor kids who see this stuff, Then there's the stress of just getting together. I know people are just, they can't even think of anything other than the fact that they've got people coming over or they've got to travel or this or that. And they just cannot enjoy the time. I don't think I put this in there, so I'm going to mention it now. A lot of churches make this time of the year hell on people. You get so busy with your cantatas and your plays and your parties and your at the church, and you can't even spend time with your own family, let alone enjoying, from Thanksgiving to New Year's. I was in those shoes once, and a couple of years I was choir director. I mean, you talk about that made me believe in purgatory. And when I cut loose of that, and of course since we started having BBF meetings, I've been totally cut loose of that stress and everything. It's been the most wonderful time of the year. Of course, now with Trump being elected, it's the most wonderful time in 8 years.
Amen.
Of course, some people suffer depression. Some get lonely. And we talked about in our prayer time, and sometimes it's their own choices. First thing, when I counsel, I've had people call me up, or I'll meet them for coffee or whatever this time of the year. This year's been one of the few that I haven't had a lot of that going on. And I'll sit down with them, and talk and chit-chat, and we'll have prayer. And I'll say, now, here I want to ask you a question. What have you done to cause this? Because everybody's always thinking about, poor me, so-and-so done this, so-and-so done that, they do this. Let's stop and start right here. What did you do that contributed to this? Yeah. And then, what's great about that is you'll see some of the things that you were pointing at, they suddenly disappear once you take care of what you did wrong. It's an amazing thing that takes place there. But I do have to say this. Some people are depressed this kind of the year and it's of no fault of their own. And I try to be very careful in dealing with people all the time, especially this time of the year, when I don't know, especially when I don't know them, and you got somebody who's depressed or cranky or whatever, folks, you don't know what they're dealing with. And you got to be very careful in dealing with those people. You know, it could be somebody whose very close loved one just died. You know, things like that. Or they could have just been diagnosed with something that's going to either be deadly or chronic and it's going to change their life. You just never know what people are going through. Got to be very considerate. Say that word with me. Considerate. Man, if that word would catch on, contentment and consideration. Those are two words. Man, if they could just catch on. And then there's the lies of the holiday hunters. And what I mean is that as we are trying to emphasize the incarnation of Jesus Christ this time of year, you got these guys who are holiday hunters, what I call them. They're constantly trying to fix everybody and tell everybody what's wrong. And they spend all their time on social media, for example, trying to tell everybody how wicked Christmas is and how evil Santa Claus is and how... you know, you're evil if you take part, if you have a Christmas tree or if you have a Christmas gathering or whatever. And most of what they say is just dishonest. But a lot of what they say, you could say, is just, what's the word? Stupid is a good word for it, but it's misplaced. I'll put it that way. In other words, like we were talking about the wise men. Someone is in a conversation or post something on social media and talking about Jesus and they quote something or maybe they even say three wise men. You think about how Satan has to love this. When there are unsaved people reading that or unsaved people hearing that conversation and here comes know-it-all Joe to disturb the conversation, to disturb the reading of that post, or whatever the case may be, to inform the world of how smart they are. Yep. And that conversation, that post has been totally derailed, and that lost person who is starting to get pulled into this conversation about God incarnate, God manifest in the flesh to die for us, he just blew it. How many people I know have done that? And here's the difference. I just want to show you this. If you look up here on my little Facebook page, this isn't even public. You can't even see this if you go on my page. The first few years of my life as a Christian, I was given this stuff by the Apostolic Oneness, the Jehovah's Witnesses, and another group, I can't remember what they were called, telling me how evil, you know, Christmas is, and all this information that I found out, most of which is false. But they convinced me. And so if you drove by my house, that's what you'd see. See that up there? What do you see?
Nothing.
Nothing. And then, so I did a little research, just like the Bereans, and I saw the stuff they said wasn't biblical. Stuff they said wasn't even historically true or accurate. And I decided, you know what? What I want people to do for about a month is to drive by my house and be reminded that God came as a baby. So for years now, you drive by the Miller house, this is what you see. For years, for several years, that's what you did see. Now just be honest, and you don't have to say it out loud. Which is God going to use? He's not going to use that. That looks like the atheist house down the road, the Mormon house down the road, the Catholic next door. Amen. How many times we had people when we had this, like we're having today, this kind of weather, people be walking their dogs and stuff, and they would just stop right in front of our house, read the scripture sign, look at the nativity, and we'd be able to walk out when we saw them. I just a few occasions where I walked out and talked to them, and I just told them, you know, I said, oh, we love your nativity, whatever this, the decorations. Well, thank you. Just trying to remind everybody that Jesus Christ came to save sinners. And then sometimes it leads to an even deeper conversation. So Satan is using all kinds of different things, and I didn't name them all, to make this the testimony of Christians during December. That's the testimony of Christians. This is totally knocked out, the majority of Christians. Now, some people live in places that couldn't do that and all that. I'm not talking, but if you can, you're able, and you've been stopped from doing that because of Satan's devices, hear me, you are losing the battle. And you could win the battle by simply doing this. And I'll tell you, and I'm not naming, again, there's different reasons why people don't do it. Some people are ashamed of that. They don't want people driving to their house and thinking they're some fanatic.
Christian.
Yeah. Amen. And that's why they'll use excuses. I think a lot of these people who are what I call holiday hunters, professing Christians, who run around always trying to get people not to celebrate Christmas, I think part of the reason, some of them do it because they're cowards. They would be scared to death to do something like that in their neighborhood. Some of them do it because they have, you know, issues about Christmas time, and because they were raised in a bad home and didn't have a good Christmas or something like that, then they turn on Christmas and, you know, try to. But Satan's using you. Whoever is like that, Satan is using you. I don't want to be used of Satan. Amen. Do you? How many of you want to be used by Satan this time of year? Any time of the year. I want to be used of God to proclaim that Jesus Christ came to save sinners.
Amen.
Whatever time of the year, whatever the circumstances, you judge and pray what's right for you to do in that circumstance. It's like there are people who won't put a t-shirt on or a hat or a bumper sticker on their car. Okay, if they wouldn't put any, you know, some people just don't like hats, you know, some people just don't like wearing shirts with things on it. Charlie didn't until he fell in love. You know, and but some people don't want things on their car. Fine. But what I have a problem with is the Christian who won't put the bumper sticker on their car or wear the hat or the t-shirt with the gospel on it, but they have no problem giving Nike free advertisement or Coca-Cola free advertisement or some stupid Greek mythology pagan Super Marvel Man, Captain America, Batman, Darth Vader. I feel cool walking around in this. Then you put the gospel on there and like, oh, what are you doing? Wouldn't it be nice just have that power to, you know, a remote and change somebody's shirt, you know? What's that? Yeah. You figure out how to do that and I'll what's it called? Invest. Now, again, don't take it out of here, and if you don't have a bumper sticker on your car right now, I'm not talking to you. I'm saying this is between you and the Lord, but you need to ask yourself, why don't I? If I can put a bumper sticker on that says, I love toads, why can't I put a bumper sticker on that says, I love Jesus?
Amen.
You see what I'm saying? That's where I'm going with that. I'm not trying to condemn people who don't like wearing shirts with things on it or whatever. I'm just saying that if you can do it for these things, why can't you do it for the Lord?
Amen.
And I went backwards. Let me get back where I was coming from. There are two kinds of people when Christmas decorations appear in the shops. There's like this, which I don't like Will Ferrell, but I like Elf. And
so it begins.
And for the entire month, Christian. A lot of them are King James Bible thumping idiots. Are used of Satan to distract everybody from the incarnation. There are those who condemn celebrations of the birth of Christ as pagan. And they claim it is Catholic and is and stolen from pagans. And it's false.
Amen.
It's a historically false claim.
Amen.
And you know who most of them quote? Pagans. They'll go find pagans to quote to accuse Christians of stealing from pagans. I got news for you folks. Pagans have a foul spirit. They're not saved.
Amen.
They're liars.
Amen.
Pagans are liars.
Amen.
They're going to lie to you. And if you don't take it upon yourself to test what they tell you, shame on you.
Amen.
Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly.
Amen.
Psalm 1:1. Memorize it. It's a good verse.
Amen.
And how much of this garbage out there distracting from the incarnation of Jesus Christ is from pagan sources, from Jehovah's Witnesses. I had a guy give me a pamphlet one time and about Christmas. And I said, do you realize this is a Watchtower publication? He's like, what's that? That is enough proof for you to stop talking and go learn something before you try to fix other people. That's what that is. So the history of the word Christmas, I want to cover for just a second, just to give you an example of the kind of holiday hunter nonsense that's used this time of year. Celebration and observance of the birth of Christ began sometime before 200 AD. Do you know what 200 AD is? We're in 2016 AD. So that's how far back you're going in time. And they'll claim that Christmas is a Roman Catholic holiday that they stole from the pagans. It's not possible.
Amen.
Roman Catholicism didn't even exist before then.
Amen.
The word that we use, Christ Christmas, does come from Christ Mass. But that word didn't even exist until sometime in the 11th century.
Yep.
That's a fact. I'm asking you, I'm begging you to look it up. But don't go to the Watchtower or pagans. Go to historic fact and find out the etymology of the word Christmas, or just the word Mass. And you'll find out there's no possible way that Christians around 200 AD were celebrating Christmas. They were celebrating the birth of Christ. The word Christmas didn't even exist. The Roman Catholic Church itself admits this. Now think of that. If Christmas or Christmas was the name of the original observance, wouldn't they claim that fact? If the Catholics were the originators and the name Christmas has been a part of that from the beginning, they would tell you. Here's what they admit in their own encyclopedia. The word Mass is from the Latin Missa, first established itself as the general designation of the Eucharist sacrifice, which we call communion. In the West, after the time of Pope Gregory, no relation, Pope Gregory the Great, in what's this date? 604. So not, all right, Christmas, Christmas. First, you had to have the word Mass in existence. And the word Mass was never used until after 604. So there's a 400-year difference between the original celebrations of the birth of Christ and the word Mass even existing. The early church having used the expression the breaking of bread, fractio panis, or liturgy, they didn't use the word Mass. Now, the word Mass, some of these holiday hunters are so, they're so ignorant. I mean, it's just ignorant. And they'll tell you the word Mass means sacrifice. No, it doesn't. The word Mass is, you're dismissed. The reason the Roman Catholic Church started calling it Mass is because